The CanAsian Arts Network recognizes and pays respect to the original peoples of this land. For time immemorial, Indigenous people have cared for and stewarded the lands known to many as Canada so that each of us today can benefit from the gifts that the land provides. Out of respect for the rights of Indigenous peoples, it is our collective responsibility to critically interrogate colonial histories and their present-day implications. We therefore work from a perspective of honoring, protecting, and sustaining the land and the people who were here first on the territory to move beyond acknowledgements and into the doing. Similarly, we recognize that the impact of colonial history and structures on our own communities and those of other people of color. We extend a hand in partnership to those who wish to move beyond allyship to become accomplices in dismantling them. Tanse ni totem. Miranda Jimmy Nisegasun, Amiskwichi Waskahika Nochi. Hello, friends. My name is Miranda Jimmy. I come to you from the heart of Treaty 6, known to many as Edmonton, the traditional lands of the Blackfoot, the Cree, the Dene, Nakota Sioux, Soto, Métis, and settlers and descendants of settlers from all over the world. I'm a proud member of Thunderchild First Nation and make my home now here in Edmonton. I work as a cultural translator and a cultural worker in a variety of ways in the sector, supporting Indigenous arts and supporting intercultural relationships so that we can all better understand each other.
Hi everyone, my name is Sean Tse. I'm a father, artist, and community organizer based in Amiskwichi Waskaikin, known as Edmonton, Treaty 6 territory and Métis homeland. I'm very grateful to have this role as a consultant also for the CanAsian Arts Network. Through funding support from Canada Council for the Arts and administrative support from Festival Access AZ, the CanAsian Arts Network has created digital content to guide, mentor, inform, and educate equity-seeking artists, cultural workers, organizations, and festivals in Canada. This series of digital literacy workshops will cover a variety of topics on business administration and legal considerations, introduction to social media and digital marketing, and encourage ways to decolonize in the digital space. These workshops will be followed up by a series of community conversations and roundtable discussions with arts leaders to help us all learn from each other. Make sure to sign up at canasianarts.com to get links to all the online content. In our next hour or so, you will have the opportunity to hear from two arts leaders sharing their perspectives on partnering with Indigenous artists.
We are so honored to have with us today Christine and Chris, who will both introduce themselves and share their ideas on this important topic. Christine, I'll turn it over to you.
Danse. Thank you very much for having me. My name is Christine Sokaymoh Frederick. I am a Cree and Métis artist, woman living here in Amiskwichi, Waskahegan, and have had family here for millennia. My family hails from Saddle Lake Cree Nation and Kikino Métis settlement with friends and family in Enoch and Musquechis as well. And I have been an artist for over 40 years, and I am very excited to share with you some of the things that I've learned about Indigenous artistic practice and the ways that we work, and maybe help out to make some connections so that the work that you do can be meaningful and beneficial, not only to your work practice, but also to the Indigenous people here in this land. Thank you. So what I have for you today is understanding Indigenous artistic practice. And that is a huge sentence. There's a lot that goes into understanding and collaborating with Indigenous people. And one of the things that I thought the best that I could offer you is perspective and language, in fact. So the first thing that I'd like to talk to you about is how can we relate to one another? And I go to my artistic senior mentors who have been doing this work for decades. And so one of the ways that we can relate to each other is understanding the differences and similarities within our mythologies. So much of our Indigenous artistic practice is rooted in our ceremonies, within our mythologies. Those mythologies tell a story of a people and their spiritual movements across a landscape. And it defines the collective dream world of races and peoples. Another way of saying it defines identity. Art, now where does it even come from? My elders, my parents, my grandparents, they always taught me that our art was embedded in our ceremonies. Those were participatory processes that were meant to communicate our humanity to the creator and therefore also to each other. And it helps to form communal identities. Now, this is important when you're kind of looking at, you know, every culture has those mythologies and stories, but how they identify time and character and God helps us to understand why we think a little bit differently. So using Thompson Highway's comparable mythologies, he is one of the, as I call him, one of the godfathers of Indigenous theater in Canada, and helped to create the Native Earth Performing Arts in Toronto. So his comparing mythologies talked about where Christian mythology may be interpreted as a collective unconscious based in one straight line from the birth of the universe all the way to the end of the universe in Armageddon. In that Christian mythology, it has one male God and he is perfect and he gave man the power to rule over nature. And the idea that time is the focus over space. However, when we compare it to Greek mythologies, we can understand that it's a bit more convoluted. We might say a bit more curved. God is neither male nor female, but both, and sometimes imperfect with a lot of frailties. And in this case, space is more important than time. And we can see that reflected by a curve. However, when we bring it down to Indigenous mythologies, many of our mythologies can be interpreted as the birth of the universe through a female force, and it is about everything that pulsates with divinity and the vast circle and cycle of life, birth, life, death, rebirth. Yeah. When we do that, we come to understand that culture, which is derived from our mythology, which we can define as the way that we do things here. That's a definition you can take anywhere. And for us in this land base, culture is what sustains us. It nurtures us and it helps us to thrive. It encapsulates our philosophy, history, experiences, skills, humor, perspectives. It is essentially our guide to spirituality and process. And process is one of the most important things to Indigenous peoples. Processes of governance, protocols, decision-making, evaluation, organization, research, how we understand our roles within our societies, our safety, our sense of justice and right and wrong. Now, this process is a progression of events, meaning that one thing must be completed before the other thing can begin, that there is a very specific order of things. You'll see this reflected in the way that we work, the way that we involve ceremony into our artistic practices. So for example, many Indigenous artists will want to have ceremony included in their artistic practice. Whereas a smudge ceremony or a pipe ceremony might be requested to be conducted, there's a very specific way that those things must be conducted. And when you do that, many of the people that will be involved will feel a sense of reassurance, will feel a sense that things are being done in a good way. And that is about building relationships. It is about opening the pathway between one another to build trust, to build a bond, to build a way of transmuting knowledge and power to one another. And it is also important, even when you are doing something practical, like negotiating a contract, many artists would appreciate those kinds of ceremonies before negotiating. Each person is different, of course. These are just guidelines and approaches that you might find useful. Sometimes it's important, though, when we are working with new groups of people and even in languages that are not necessarily our first or even our second language, it's important to touch on vocabulary. Who are we talking about? What words are we using to describe each other? Now, when we're talking about Indigenous people, there are a lot of words to use, and there are a lot of different meanings. And I find when I do work with a diverse group of people, this is some of the most beneficial work that we can do, which is just start at the same definitions together. So we're going to start with the first one, which is in some ways a misnomer. We understand that the first explorers to North America called us, you know, erroneously Indians. However, policymakers carried that further with legislation, so the Indian Act of 1876. So although there have been many amendments to the Indian Act, it is still an active piece of legislation, and therefore in some cases that word Indian is in fact the right word to use. And it has legal connotations to it that are conferred from the government, and there are deep relationships that are associated with that word. However, it's not one that people commonly use to describe a cult. It's a political identity, I suppose I mean to say. So we'll go into a bit of another word that's used often, and that's the word Aboriginal. Now, this word was defined in our Constitution in 1982 under Section 35, and it includes the First Nations people. And those are both status and non-status Indians. Those are people who have registered with the federal government. Now, within those First Nations, status and non-status, that's where you also have all of the different tribes and bands that there are. The second type of Aboriginal person in Canada is an Inuit person, and those people are traditionally from the northern areas. However, with modern day transportation and availability of movement, there are Inuit people all over North America. The third is the Métis. Now, the Métis is a person who first and foremost self-identifies as a Métis, as distinct from other Aboriginal peoples, and has a historical ancestry and is also accepted by the formal Métis nation. So Aboriginal, because it's within our constitution and is defined within these three different types of people, it also refers to our rights in this country, our hunting and harvesting, voting, education rights, all these things that we have a right to. So a lot of people like that word. However, there's another word that has reached a lot of prevalence in society, and it is an important word, and that's the word Indigenous. Now, this word had initially a sort of scientific definition that meant flora and fauna of this territory, and that was used by scientists for hundreds of years. However, the United Nations understood that something was happening worldwide, and they defined Indigenous populations as the existing descendants of people who inhabited a present territory at a time when a different culture or ethnic origin arrived there and from other parts of the world and overcame them, either by conquest, settlement, or other means, and reduced them to a non-dominant or a colonial situation. So when you're discussing human rights violations, this term is essential in raising awarenesses and developing protective legislation. However, it's important to understand that it is in and of itself, it's not a cultural identity or an ethnic identity. It's a political identity that's meant to increase and redress human rights violations, increase awareness of and redress human rights violations. So being an oppressed human being has an impact on culture and its identity, but it does not wholly spring from that experience. Now, what does this all mean when we talk about Indigenous art practice? Well, this becomes an imperative. When Indigenous people practice art, they are, in fact, redressing those human rights violations. We are correcting and rebuilding our cultural identity. Things that occurred to us through the colonization, through the Indian Act, through the oppression of Indigenous people on this land, our identities were essentially stripped from us by preventing us to speak our own languages, by preventing us to pass down our own traditions to each other, by preventing our ability to communicate our humanity to the Creator. We've got a situation where it's imperative that we rebuild that. So when Indigenous people do art, that's what we're doing. It's big stakes and it's huge work. Now we have another word, and I'm so grateful that the organizers of this beautiful talk also mentioned the treaties in their land acknowledgement. And I bring this up just a little bit so that people understand that we, you know, here in Edmonton, we are in Treaty Number 6 territory. But what are these treaties? And Canada has many treaties, and they developed over a period of time, and there have been amendments to them. But what a treaty is an agreement to relate to one another and how we would agree on relating to one another. The treaties are important because it is what allows Canada to be a legal entity. Without the treaties, there wouldn't be a legal entity of Canada. So this is important and can't be lost. Now, when we get to working with artists, many come with goals. They have their own artistic practice and art form, whether it's in film, media, or visual arts, or fashion arts, or theater, dance. Many artists will look for certain things that'll help them identify strong partnerships and strong collaborators. And one of those things is those projects that will help us to build the artistic vitality of our community. Excuse me. In the work that I've done over the last 20 years, not only within my own community, but also working nationally and internationally with global Indigenous people and artists, these are things that I have gleaned from all of my mentors and elders and people that when we gather and discuss these issues, this is what sifts down to some of the important aspects of what the work that we do. Excuse me, one moment. My apologies. I'm recovering from an illness. When we are looking at partnering, when we're looking at work that we want to do in our community, the first thing that many of us look for is access. Do we have access to some of the obvious things? Access to funding, development, access to spaces. One of the things that I think is one of the most profound is access to each other. How we are able to identify other Indigenous artists, how we're able to work with each other and have access. When I began this work, of course, Indigenous artists have been around for millennia, but because of certain policies, Canadian policy in regards to their approach to Indigenous arts, there wasn't a lot of identifying communities of Indigenous artists. And so having access to each other is profound. The next thing that we need is inclusion. Now, inclusion is sort of access's big sister. It's the next step. It's not only can I get in the door, but do I have a key to the door? Can I come in when I want? Am I included in decision-making opportunities, in key casting and story creation, content creation? Am I included and able to contribute in a way that I can define? And the third thing is identity and recognition. That's the identity of and of the different art forms that Indigenous people are practicing and recognition of those. So for example, in 2009, when I first started one of my companies, Alberta Aboriginal Arts, and we applied for funding to put on a contemporary play, we were not funded, even though there was an Indigenous stream of funding. They only funded traditional arts. And the funder defined what that was, not the artists themselves, just the funder. So that became an issue with recognizing our art forms. Then we have appreciation. Are the artists actually appreciated? You know, and are they getting accolades? Are they being promoted for opportunities? And the last thing is self-determination. And again, that goes to autonomy and choice and decision-making. Are we allowed to evolve our own art forms and determine where we're going with that? And that those are great measures of artistic vitality of any project and or community. Here are some other things that I've gleaned from those global Indigenous people who have wise practices and shared them with us. So there is respect. That's the top one. I think that goes with almost any project on the planet that anybody wants to do. If we can honor cultural elements through you know, gaining appropriate training and permissions, looking at long-term aspects of the work that we do. Relationship is really important, and it's the center of, like I said, our philosophies and our culture, to seek those relationships, not just for yourself, but cross-cultural collaboration. Indigenous people also look for relevance. When you're working within our cultural elements, that they are relevant to the work, that they follow and uplift original protocols and contexts. And in this regard, this is why it's really helpful to work with elders and knowledge keepers to understand the relevance of the work that you're doing and how to maintain that relevance as you're working within it. Reciprocity is vital. This is about acknowledgement and giving space and fair compensation for those cultural knowledge sharers, understanding that there is a give and a take. And this is, again, when you go back to how you compare the way we think, understanding that there's that circle, things will come back. We'll be different, but things will come back. And reciprocity is a part of that. Responsibility, understanding that when we are looking for content or that we have a responsibility to work with original creators, with cultural insiders, to keep ourselves humble and self-aware, that whether you're contracting somebody or asking them to participate, you have a responsibility to uphold their knowledge in a way that keeps that knowledge in their house. The other one is representation. Now, this is, you know, I think is a topic, especially in film and media right now, in understanding that we want proper representation, Indigenous people representing Indigenous people. We no longer want to be played by Italians, and we want to be played by ourselves. So representation is important in all of its contexts. Now, one of the things that I get asked a lot about is whether we are appropriating or appreciating work of Indigenous people. And people try to understand how do we understand that? So to know if you're appropriating or appreciating is if you receive a benefit. So if you are unacknowledged or are using an inappropriate adoption of the practices, customs, and aesthetics of one social group to another. So this occurs across cultures. It's the idea that you're making it your own private property, something that you will take something of somebody else's and create a new design and calling it your own. So there's a lot to go on with that. The other aspect of identity is to understand that there's different levels or different aspects of identity. And this is a really big topic right now because we've got heritage identity. Those are people who have connections to their indigeneity based primarily on ancestry or lineage, genetic past. Then we have people who have connections to a political identity based on their eligibility for status or registering with the government, having a card. Then there are people who live with a cultural identity, where they have active participation in their own cultural processes, where they have in how they govern and how they educate and how they pass on their knowledge. So these are three different ways to look at identity. And there are other aspects that we could go deeply into, but I do want to leave room for any questions and any further knowledge to share with each other. So I thank you very much. And we'll stop my presentation at that point. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Christine. So much to take in there as far as Indigenous ways of knowing and being. And I look forward to an opportunity to chat further about some of the ideas you brought forward. Now I'll turn it over to Chris. Chris, I look forward to hearing what you have to share on working with Indigenous artists.
Yeah, thank you very much. I'm going to share my screen here. And yeah, thanks so much, Christine. That really, it just really triggered all the things that, you know, I've learned over the years as a documentary filmmaker as well. And it's really helpful to always like get a refresher on that. But I guess I should introduce myself. My name is Chris Hsiung. I am a documentary filmmaker. My full Chinese name is Hsiung Yuming, and I am the 23rd generation of the Hsiung family, documented generation. So my parents were born in China and you know, generations before that, but now I live and work in Calgary in the heart of Treaty 7 territory. So just a little bit about myself. I'm a typical child of a Chinese immigrant parents. I did very well in school. I fit into Canadian culture and had to learn how to do that. But I spoke Mandarin at home and absorbed a lot of the Chinese culture, mostly through osmosis. And it's, in some ways, it's not surprising. It's part of that stereotype. I studied engineering and I worked for Nortel for a decade. And while I found software design really interesting, I also found it really narrowly focused. And I was interested in the world around me and what was going on there. I was concerned about many of the social issues that were starting to make themselves known to me. And so it turned out that documentary filmmaking was this blend of like the technical, the creative, and the managerial. So it was like this thing that I found that I thought I would really love to do this. And so I left engineering. I started Hidden Story Productions like 12 years ago, borrowed some money, bought a camera, and began this really incredible learning journey that has taken me all across Alberta, all the way from, you know, writing on stone up to Fort Chippewa and High Level. Those are all places I never knew growing up in Calgary. And I've delved a lot deeper into the Indigenous history of the province of Canada. And then through that, I've met, you know, people from many cultures, a lot of backgrounds. And what I've learned is that the camera is something that gives you permission to step into worlds that you normally wouldn't be allowed to step into. And, you know, and so for my parents, yes, I do make a good living. So I have a career now. And that's kind of important for my parents. And I was always worried to tell them about this new career direction. But in the end, they were super happy for me. So that's good to know. So this is a recent picture of my family. I think it's a very Canadian family. It's what my parents and I love and appreciate about Canada. It's this multicultural, multilingual, and we really take it for granted that this is normal here. You know, like I've traveled to other places, whether in Europe or Taiwan or Sri Lanka. Like my wife and I, we get some active stares, not anything vicious, but just kind of some very direct questions about like, how are we together? How is this even possible? My son, you know, is Chinese looking, but has a brown mom, right? And this is something that I feel like can only be really explored in Canada. And I think that's something that has also shaped my perspective and how I see the world. And so I want to share, like, I share that background mainly because it's like, I think this immigrant perspective, this child of an immigrant perspective, provides a really unique view on things. And I think there's some real strengths. You know, some of you may be just like me, Chinese or from other Asian backgrounds. And I think there's an experience in that of growing up that way that we shouldn't underestimate. And so I'm going to share some of those like advantages, I think, of as being an immigrant. And so one of the big things is this ability to navigate culture. So I think one of the first abilities you develop is that because, you know, for me, I spoke Mandarin at home and I ate Chinese food and learned a whole set of, you know, what I would say would be more like Confucian Chinese values. But during the day, I was going to a white Canadian school as the only Chinese person in the class. And it's funny because even though I was the only Chinese person in the class, my parents, whenever we talk about Canadians, we call them Waiguoren, which means like foreigners. So we always talked about Canadians as being foreigners. So here I am. I am in a foreign land, and I had to learn how to navigate that. And I think that's something you just have to learn. You have to learn how to do. But when it comes to like filmmaking, it actually was precisely the skill set that allowed me to travel and to be in different places. So this is me filming in Nepal. I worked with a nonprofit organization, and we worked with some of the poorer communities in Kathmandu. And there that immediately, for me at least, a sensitivity to their cultural practices, you know, a recognition of like the privilege that I bring and the biases I may be entering in with, not just as a Canadian, but also as a Chinese person. But that upbringing, you know, made me very attuned to that. And I think it was really helpful. It's also allowed me to learn and navigate Indigenous culture. The way I kind of felt was that it was very much like when I, you know, approach Canada from an immigrant perspective, which is, you know, you learn to like be humble. You learn to really pay attention to pay attention, right? Just to be open to whatever learning it is that you don't know. Like you understand that you don't understand this culture, and so you have to learn. And I think a big thing for me was like also being open to making mistakes. It's one of those things that, like for example, even learning how to offer protocol for elders. That reminded me a lot of the awkwardness of me talking to my aunts and uncles from Taiwan and Indonesia and not knowing what to do, not knowing what to say, because I, you know, as much as I'm Chinese, I'm not like, I didn't grow up in Chinese culture. So for me, I developed this kind of comfort with that feeling of not knowing what I'm supposed to do. And it's like, but as long as I'm learning, that's okay. And I think another ability I think of as a child of immigrant parents is that I could recognize the advantages and disadvantages of different cultures. Like I was constantly navigating cultures. So, you know, we think of culture as it is what we breathe. It's what we assume is normal. And anything outside of that can feel abnormal, right? But for me, as kind of a, I would say, a cultural mutt, you stand slightly outside of that, like not knowing, well, am I Chinese? Am I Canadian? Am I both? What is that? And I can safely say I love Chinese culture, like the ethic of education as a path to enlightenment, of hard work, of being like persistent, that belief in craftsmanship. You know, China's culture is also very much about, it's a collectivist type culture about being stronger together. And that there are things that are worth doing for the greater good. And that's something we noticed in the pandemic. Our family was like, yes, you have to do things for the greater good. But I also really love Western culture too, right? Because of its valuing of individual expression, of its ability to break norms, you know, challenge authority, right? Which is not something that Chinese people are necessarily, Chinese culture rather, is not necessarily known for. And there's kind of an ambition there to change the world, which I do appreciate. At the same time, because I am neither culture, I can also be critical of like, you know, Chinese overemphasis on conformity and being the same. And and you know, that perhaps a little bit too much of a love for authoritarian rule. And I can be very critical of Western individual selfishness, you know, where it's all about you and not about like all of us. So likewise, it really is of no offense to me when I hear Canada being criticized for its colonial past or neo-colonial present, right? And likewise, I can be very critical of China, you know, I mean, really, like the amount of human rights violations that happened there and the massacre. So what I'm getting at is that growing up in these two worlds, I can see the best in both, but also see like the problems with each. And I could have this like perspective of seeing the best and worst of our cultures. And to me, it also gives us an opportunity, which is that we can create like new narratives, right? Like new ways forward that perhaps are better. And so that is probably a long way of like kind of saying that growing up here in Alberta, learning about Indigenous culture was kind of a natural progression of like wanting to learn more about the culture that I didn't know. You know, I didn't have as much of an assumption of what Alberta should be. I grew up with a certain perspective, but then later on when I realized there was more to it, like I kind of wanted to know more about it, right? Because this is supposed to be my home. And I know, like, at least here, I hear a lot of like land acknowledgements, which this session started with. And sometimes people can feel that it becomes just sort of rote and something that just gets said. But for me, the whole curiosity about Indigenous culture in Alberta started with hearing a land acknowledgement for the very first time. You know, I can't remember how long ago, it was about 10 years ago. And that actually started this whole journey of what is Treaty 7? Like, what is that? Like, it's not something I learned in school. It's not something I grew up with. And it led to asking like some friends, okay, what is that all about? And what is Indigenous culture? And all those sorts of questions that you first start, you know, as if I was like new to Alberta again. And then it eventually led me to this theater group called Making Treaty 7, which was a theatrical group with Michael Green at the helm, who brought together Indigenous and non-Indigenous actors and musicians to really tell the story of Treaty 7. And this group was really what connected me to a lot of different people, artists and elders. And it led to my very first documentary, where a Blackfoot filmmaker and myself went on a road trip to explore the history of Southern Alberta. And this was a film that led to an incredible journey through my life in terms of learning about, you know, what home is all about. And I'll show here just a trailer about it so you can get a sense of what this film was about and how I was very much ended up in the film, because, you know, we were both trying to learn the history of Southern Alberta.
Cowboy Smith.
Good to see you.
Good to see you again.
I'm glad you made it.
Yeah, well, I'm really happy to be here on your land, you know?
I've heard that before.
Both of us are foreigners. Foreigners to our heritage and to our home. Sure, I grew up here, but my parents were Chinese immigrants, coming from a place I know little of. As for Cowboy, he is a Blackfoot Indian, living a modern nomadic life on Turtle Island, cut off from his heritage through assimilation. Both of us are wondering, what is this place we call home? How did it come to be? And why is it even relevant?
I started questioning my last name, Smith. I'm like, where the hell does this name come from? Like, this is not a Blackfoot name. What the hell is going on?
They were talking about you and your children to come. There's no difference. And that's what Albertans don't understand. They think that 130 years ago was far enough back that we can wash those away, but no. We gotta make treaty like it was yesterday. just yesterday.
As long as I can have my party in a perfect English garden, nature noise is less annoying with a healthy dose of poison. As long as I can shoot and suck and plow and blast away, I promise you that I'll improve this harsh terrain with every passing day.
Do you know what you're doing? The folly is when we think that man is it. It's a folly. And that's a kind word for stupidity.
You know, you really have to take yourself out of your living room and get out here to the land and talk to the land, hear the land, feel the land, let it affect you, open yourself up to it. That's what I'm realizing now in this journey, this decision to be this elder in the making.
Wow, man, we do look really young in that, don't we? so that film really actually it made such a huge impact in my life, you know, in terms of my understanding of where we live and that history of it. It's a film that won a Best Documentary Award and Sun CBC, and it's like traveled in education curriculums, but partly I think you know, because it was somebody like me who was trying to learn it and trying to make this effort to learn this history. And I think that at that time, there's a lot of people who are also trying to learn this history and didn't know it and could kind of connect with that. So it's the whole film opened me up to this whole tragic history. But more than that, it actually connected me to a real rich culture that I wasn't taught in school. And this was also a great place to make a lot of those mistakes as well, too, like protocols of how to approach elders. And that, you know, I remember being at Sundance and just not knowing what I'm supposed to do. I'm supposed to do this or that, or what I'm not supposed to do or can do. And then once you get by that, then it's like, oh, okay, you know, you start getting a sense of what it's meant for. You start developing those relationships, and it becomes much more clear, like the depth and richness of that. And I'd say another big learning from that was the that deep connection with the landscape that I had never really had. And I feel like there's something in, you know, to be about immigrant culture where it's like this idea of like hiking or camping or being out on the land is kind of this ridiculous idea. You know, we just left to come for like a better life, and now you want us to like go in a sleeping bag and sleep in a tent. It's just, this idea is not part of it. But part of going on this journey and going on this film has really given me a sense of like the prairies in a way that I never experienced, when you don't get when you just drive from like Calgary to Edmonton in your car. And so, you know, this was a place that I had stayed, and you know, just being able to see the beautiful northern lights, and like that was an experience I got to have, like in this experience of making the film. And it made me appreciate like the landscape all the more. But beyond that, it was also about the fundamental connection between Indigenous culture and the land, and the specific geography and geology and the natural flow and energy of that. I don't actually remember what I have next here. Okay, now I do. So when I started exploring Southern Alberta, that was like one part of Alberta. And then, you know, and I'm sorry, apologize, Christine. I used to think that Northern Alberta, like that's like Edmonton. I was just like, that's Northern Alberta. Edmonton is like so far out there. Well, it turns out Edmonton is just like Central Alberta. So there's like a whole other part that's north of Alberta that I had never explored before. And so one of the other films, and I'll show you a quick trailer of it, that led me to the entire opposite end of like the province, which is up into northern Alberta in a place called Fort Chippewa. And we went there while Elder in the Making was done in the hot summer prairies. Fox Chaser, this next film, was filmed up in the cold depths of winter. And I'll just show you a quick clip from it.
This is the last free lifestyle I can maintain. I'm a wild fur harvester and a food provider for myself and my community. It does me a lot of good. You know, it brings back, you know, my sense of creativity, my ability to be in tune with nature, be in tune with myself. I'm reminded every day that this environment is changing, and changing fast. And I know it's not gonna last forever. I can turn back time 40 years and be a part of that. And in this day and age, we don't see that. We don't see anybody in the bush. It's now. It's now or never.
So this one was a lovely and beautiful film, and it was also really cold. I don't think I've been like filmed in minus 20, minus 30 degree weather and lived to tell about it. So what I think this film, you know, we had a chance to work with a trapper that took up to Fort Chippewa, and that sense of being like in a trapper's cabin where all of your like survival is dependent on things like, you know, that are right there. Like you have to cut the wood to put it into the stove to keep yourself warm. For the water, you have to draw it from the lake. Like there's a sense that like, oh yeah, we actually like depend on like the world around us, the natural world around us to survive. And there's something you don't get that in an urban environment. And also there was this sense of being with the trapper is that like, there's this conflict between living in nature, which he loved, but he realized that this is not something that billions of people on the planet can do, right? So how do we resolve that? And this is also a trapper that loves to work as a trapper, but also has to work for the oil and gas industry in order to make a living, right? And so it was kind of like, yeah, this is the struggle that we all have, you know, in terms of we depend a lot on the industry. But at the same time, we know that we need to live a better way. And so I just felt that this was something that spoke to us. And that's something that I've realized is like all these stories, they really do connect to like who we are. And so as a result of, you know, my career so far, the camera, it's taken me all over Alberta, and each story has really enriched my understanding of the place that I call home. And each story tells me something about or teaches me something about being human, you know, which is lovely and it's messy and it's kind of a reminder that we're all part of this journey to find a better way forward. And so these projects culminated in one of like the most rewarding and challenging projects of my life. I was approached to put together a team for a new multimedia cultural center at Fort Edmonton Park called the Indigenous Peoples Experience. This had long been a missing feature at Heritage Park, and now they wanted to tackle it in a big way. But Fort Edmonton was really struggling with the content and how to go about it. And, you know, like the exhibit designers from New York didn't know anything about Edmonton, right? And this was actually a chance for, well, potentially our team to be able to go in and take all that experience and apply to it. So what this is, it's an immersive exhibit gallery. So it's a combination of like text and reproductions and history and photos, but also multimedia projections. And even like, you know, before we took on the contract, and I think Christine spoke to something about how vital it is like for for this cultural work to be built. Like, it's not something to be taken for granted. And Barry and others, like, together, we thought, it's like, should we even be doing this, right? Like, are we the right people to do it? And if we do it, like, what would doing it with integrity look like? Because this was not just sort of a fun side project. Like, this was something really important to Indigenous communities and cultures. And in this respect, like, even before we started, we talked to a number of our elders and thought, you know, is this something like we can do and should we be doing it? And when we got sort of the go ahead there, that's when we felt like, okay, we can try to tackle this. And so it was just one of those things that, you know, the experience that we've had over like the last 10 years of like talking to many people across Alberta, we learned a lot, and we took those lessons that we've learned and really tried our best to apply it in this project. You know, but this project took over two years, and the credit list for, and this is just for Hidden Story Productions, was like 500 people. Like, we probably worked with over 500 people on this, and it took everything we learned to make it happen. So I'll try to share some of what we learned, and some of it are things that Christine has already mentioned, which is one of the big things for us was consultation is always a big thing, but for us, we've kind of learned that consultation is also like not quite the right word for it either, right? It's kind of gives a sense like, okay, well, I'll consult with you and then we'll just do whatever the heck we want. It's like, no, for us, it was like not about consultation, it was about relationship, right? That consultation for us, quote unquote, was really about having a lot of tea with elders, you know? So it's just, we took the time to search out those stories from community, and those stories are like connected to a particular place, right? So it's not something you can really Google. You can't import it from other parts of the country. And so I think what you'll see in the exhibit is that you'll see direct quotes. You'll see an effort to avoid like that museum voice, right? We want the voice to be in there. Another important thing that we did was this fundamental concept of reciprocity, right? So a lot of what it means is like it's not just about, you know, compensation, but it's also about like how do we make sure that the community benefits from like this work. And so even contractually, for example, like we've long in media had this thing where basically you just like sign over all your rights over to the filmmaker, and we're like, no, we're not going to do that. We can't own these stories, right? And so how do we have essentially like this info sharing agreement where we like, you know, it's like, no, this is not our stories. This is the collective stories of the community. And if the community wants those stories, you know, they can have those stories. And similarly, like if we were sharing stories that are like, for example, one of the big media elements was about like the Cree creation story. Now it's a fairly sacred story, and we had to figure out like what parts of it can we tell and not tell. And our creative team actually did a 4-day camp with an elder to like learn the creation story, and knowing it enough that like we understood what was an appropriate way to communicate that. So, you know, those are all elements of reciprocity, I think, that were really important to us and really helped us to tell like a story with integrity, essentially. And so in starting the project, we also had like ceremony and you know, had those blessings. But even our regular get-togethers, you know, we would get together in a circle and smudge, and each time we would actually almost put together our own little bundle that to kind of capture that journey. And at the end, you know, there was these like bone needles that we actually used to stitch the ITP that at the very end. But this was all the more important because we were gathering groups of people that were, you know, Cree, Blackfoot, Dene, Métis, Nakota, like all different cultures coming together. And so, we need to do that in the right way. Another element that I think that's become very important, and Barry emphasized this too. Of course, Barry, one of the first things he told me, Barry is the director, he's Cree-Métis. And one of the things he didn't want is for him to be like the only person to like you know, answer all Indigenous questions, right? Which tends to be a weakness. It's like, oh, you hired the Indigenous director and then you just get that director to do everything. It's like, no. We wanted to make sure that there was like a working group that could support him in the process, whether it's like historians, whether, you know, we had like David Garneau for art direction. We had like Métis historians. We had like a director that came in from a different Indigenous director who had a different skill set for different things. And so I think one of the things that was important to us was like, how do you maintain, keep the creative in like Indigenous hands, right? So again, like that consultation, that relationship, very important. But in the creative process, because like, you know, we wouldn't necessarily ask an elder, it's like, oh, how would you do this animation, right? Because they're not specialists in that. But how do we maintain that like creative voice throughout the process? And this is where we, you know, we worked with lots of technical teams. Like we had teams in Montreal and we had teams in LA, but how did we make sure those are aligned with the voice? And so that's where things like having David Garneau providing that art direction really helped, and that having this working group where we constantly checked in with the stories to make sure all along the way, it's like, okay, is this a story to tell? Are we missing anything? And there's that check-in. And in our music as well too, we had some wonderful composers, directors, performers, people like Mo Clark, Chris Dirksen, and in the cinematography and direction as well too. Something I want to add, and I'm noticing that I'm going a little over time, I'm sorry, is that it's not just about the content, it's also about the process. So we filmed a lot of difficult scenes. And so, you know, something that can be easily forgotten and is like to have like that elder in there that can hold the space on the scene for filming these difficult scenes, that we shouldn't hold that space, especially for the youth that we were working with. And even then we still made mistakes, you know, like in terms of how accounting sometimes conflicts with how gifts and protocols are supposed to match, or how like we had an on-site installation team trying to tell an elder how the TP is supposed to be built. You know, like it's kind of like you have to navigate and negotiate all those teams when you come together. And but the result, I feel like it kind of speaks for itself. It's a project that not only ended up winning an international award for outstanding heritage exhibit, but more importantly, when in, you know, my Indigenous friends and Indigenous people have visited, they comment on how they see their aunts and their uncles in there, and they actually recognize the people that are there, and they can tell that this is like their voice in it. And for me, that's the highest compliment you can get, even though that's not officially the most important thing. Officially, it's like, will it bring more people into Fort Edmonton Park, right? But for our team, it's like, you know, are we doing it with integrity? And I wish I had time to show you a little clip, but we're kind of running out of time. There, have some like highlights from the show, so you'll have to just look it up yourself and go visit the exhibit. It's called The Indigenous People's Experience. And I'll just end with that. This is my son who I took to the Indigenous People's Experience, and I know that my son, he's going to grow up in a very different environment, much further ahead than I was. He'll know about Treaty 7. He'll know about Indigenous culture. He'll have Indigenous friends. And there'll always be more to do, right? Like, so for me as a filmmaker, the goal of telling these stories is to create a more like intelligent and more compassionate, a more just society. And I think stories help to tell that. And if there's anything that I've learned in this whole process, is that a place becomes home for you when you really inhabit it, when you learn about it, when you like contribute to it. And help it grow. And so I think especially as immigrants, kids of immigrants, doesn't quite feel like home, but from an intergenerational perspective, we learn to make a place home. And I think that's what I hope for my son. So thank you.
Thank you so much, Chris and Christine. My head is aflutter with all of the amazing perspectives that you brought. So I don't consider myself an artist. I'm an arts administrator. I'm a curator. I'm a project manager. I leave the art creation to other folks. But I always see art as creative expression. And the two of you brought different perspectives that really kind of opened my eyes. Christine, you talked about art as an expression of culture and a practice of culture. And Chris, you talked about it as, you know, permission to ask questions and maybe go places that you wouldn't go otherwise. So I'm just curious from both of you, if art is maybe one or all of those things, how do you navigate that, bringing in different worldviews? We'll start with you, Chris.
How do you navigate that, bringing in worldviews? Well, I think, you know, particularly as a documentary filmmaker, you're constantly trying to like listen to what's being said, but what's also underneath what's being said. And for me, like history is an important component of that. Like you can't just look at like the situation like right in front of you. There's a whole like story that leads up to those different perspectives. So I think if I were to say it maybe simply, is like you need a certain level of like humbleness to be like to be open to not know, and not assume that you know, because yeah, one thing that's done in one culture may seem like counter to the culture that you grew up in, but that doesn't mean it's like wrong right away, right? Like it's like, you know, it's different. So why is that, you know, and be curious about that. So that's a short answer, I guess.
Yeah, that's a really fascinating question, because at first I wasn't really even sure what you meant. I'm like, how do I bring in worldviews into my art? I don't. I bring my view. But just as you say, when I take a step back, I'm both an artist, but I'm also a presenter of art, a producer of art. I run several festivals, so that I think I forgot to mention in my bio that I'm the executive director of Dreamspeakers Festival Society. And we're coming up on 30 years in April. So it's our 30th anniversary. And we are an international Indigenous film festival. And indeed, one of the big challenges we have is articulating, when we do our call outs, what we're looking for. It's imperative that we have an understanding of what we think our audiences are looking for, understanding who our audiences are, and with that idea of curation and bringing things in that would expand knowledge and perspective. And I think that's where I would kind of land to answer that question, is we're not in the pursuant of sharing perspective to be right or wrong, or but rather to know more. You know, and so when we're curating both for the film festival or for the Rubaboo Arts Festival, I'm looking at artists that will help us to expand our knowledge, our understanding, to know more, not to necessarily know everything, but just to know more, to have that that exciting, enthusiastic curiosity, you know. And it's in, and when we open it to understanding that art is about humanity, then it really does open everything wide up, because it's everything that we are, and it's everything. So we can navigate that by, I think, as we've sort of mentioned, that idea of humbleness, in that this is who I am, this is my art, this is how I see the art, but it's also a reflection of you and how you see your art and how we can meet together and what that looks like together, especially when we do collaborative work, right? Exactly like Chris's work that you've done in the two films that you presented. Beautiful collaboration between yourself and the Indigenous people that you're working with. I'm so pleased to see that quality of work, because there's a humbleness there that doesn't say, I know how this works. It's the humbleness that I will learn how this can work. And so that's sort of how we navigate it, is taking a step back and finding similarities, celebrating those similarities, but not shying away the things that make us difference, because it's those things that can actually help refine our understanding of who we are and our place, not only here on this land, but within that greater universe. You know, some of the most powerful things I've seen is when we've got, well-established Indigenous artists who get to sit and learn from our old people, our elders, and see the profound enlightenment that happens, where they kind of, I forgot, that's who we were. That's who we are. We are so much more than the fight to decolonize. We were someone before colonization, and we are still those people. And how we navigate that, both in our contemporary work, how we reference our historical work, is part of that magic, that weaving.
I think, yeah, thank you both for those beautiful presentations and those beautiful answers. I'm trying to center a question around the audiences that would be mainly watching this, the CanAsian Arts Network community. And I think that, beyond we're at a time right now where a lot of our systems and a lot of the ways that our society in Canada is heading towards is around this concept of decolonization. And we see that, definitely as like a priority within our network. But I feel like as we navigate this as a collective community, there's also just so many diverse entry points and experiences within that, right? And so it is hard for systems to gauge what is the level of where people are at. However, we are presented with this thing where it's like, it is very important to be aware and to, like we mentioned, the act of doing the work of decolonization. And so maybe just, from a lot of the experiences that you both have shared, if our audience is like brand new, but thinking of how to collaborate with Indigenous community on an art project, are there any specific tips on how they should be thinking about this process? Anything that you think would be very helpful for them to, frame within all this navigation?
I'm sorry, I don't mean to be flippant, but isn't that just the presentations we both just gave?
Well, no, absolutely, absolutely. I think that, like, I'm trying to think of something very specifically tangible, right? Like, in terms of, like, obviously watching, like, more content, right? But if they're also creating, like, or trying to think about collaboration, like, reaching out to Indigenous community, right? Like, is there something that they need to continue to do? Is it about, like, actually doing more research? Or do they just message someone, right? Like, I'm trying to think of first steps, right? Because I think that there's this pressure for us to also, like, in this term of intercultural solidarity or, Indigenous solidarity, like these ideas that, the Arts Council wants us to, think about Indigenous traditional knowledge and respecting all of that. And so I feel like there are like certain kind of pressures on us to conform to the way that, that we know and should be addressing things, but there isn't actually that many tools out there, which is also why we're creating, this workshop, right? But I am curious to see, like, what would some of those, like, first steps be that you think artists should be looking at?
Well, I guess I'll just pick up on that thread of, like, how the sort of those first steps and what, at least I could speak to, certainly for me, how it happened. whether it applies to anybody else, we'll leave it to the audience. I think, I mean, certainly curiosity was sort of the first step. Like, you know, the concept of treaties was very, very new to me, right? Like Treaty 7, I literally thought the Treaty 7 had something to do with the Group of Seven. Like, I know it's embarrassing now when I look back on it, but I mean, 7-7, that's all I knew about it, right? I was like, okay, I need to know more about this. And so asking around my friends, it's like, hey, anybody like connected, you know, can hook me up, you know, like let me know who I can meet with or talk with or be a part of. A friend of mine had been working with the Morley community, the Stoney Nakota. It's a town just, you know, near Banff that I have driven by my entire life by, but never knew was there, right? So it's kind of like, wow, it's like, I didn't know there was like an Indigenous community right there. And so a friend of mine said, well, why don't you just come and I'll introduce you to some people and maybe you can just help out and, you know, meet some people. I was like, sure, come on, you know, kind of all awkward, like meeting people, talking to people. It's just like, okay, yeah, this is here. Like it was kind of like for step one, right? To know that it's even here. And then as I met people, I started like, okay, well, I held a filmmaking workshop there and I met more people. And then I started meeting other elders who would then just invite me out, you know, if they liked me, I guess, or maybe they liked me. And so it's okay, well, why don't you come out to like this camp or like this? So it's sort of how you might imagine relationships being built. It's not something you know, it's not like I wouldn't necessarily recommend just calling up an elder and say, hey, can you invite me to a Sundance? Like that's not the approach for that, right? Like it's that relationship building, and that sort of takes time. I wish there was a five-step plan to making relationships, but I don't think there really is. Like it all depends on your personality and what your time and place, your willingness to contribute. Because I also think there is a challenge where an elder also doesn't have like all the time in the world, you know what I mean? Like it's not, I wouldn't necessarily be like, oh, here's the elder's phone number, everybody just call. Like it's like, no, it would be so overwhelming as well too, right? So I feel like Christine can carry on from there, but that's just a little bit about my initial experience of that, which might be helpful to people.
Absolutely, Chris. That was fantastic. And I would just kind of riff off of that. And the first thing would be educate yourself. You know, just as Chris said in his presentation, he grew up here, but there was so much he didn't even know. Don't expect that you're going to learn things in school, because the things about us that are important weren't taught in school until recently. So educate yourself and take in different forms of education. And one of the things that I absolutely enjoyed about the making of Treaty 7 project, and I was on the the advisory committee when it first began in 2013 and at the first creation residency. And one of the things that I adored about the project and understood why it was so good and profound was the required reading to even participate in the project was from an Indigenous perspective, looking at history from the Indigenous perspective, written by Indigenous people. And so educate yourself beyond the colonial ideas of how we educate ourselves. And I would say, attend and support the work of Indigenous people. Do that first. So one of the things I get very frustrated with, especially when TRC came around, because our office was inundated daily, hundreds of calls of non-Indigenous organizations and groups and institutions wanting to partner like now, without any idea that we're already doing the work and you just jumped in and decided you're going to make a project because you heard there's funding. Don't do that. spend some time to support the work that Indigenous people are already doing themselves. They need that support. They want your support. And that support will go a long way to building relationships and attending those events, right? Like it's exactly imperative to go see the work that Indigenous people are doing, because that's where you will get that education. You know, we have in our film festival, we have anywhere from 20 to 50 films every year, both in person and online. And they are both local, national, and international films. And in the last couple of years, we've gotten more and more films from places that I wouldn't have not normally thought, because we've just, the reach is so much farther now in our prevalence for technology and whatnot. So you can get a lot of interesting perspectives, traditions, and contemporary life and work. The other thing would be, understand that those relationships and trust take time. You know, I said that I got those calls from people who are like, yeah, we've already wrote the proposal. We want you to be involved. We're offering, you know, partnership or collaboration. Can you write us a letter of support? It's due tomorrow. It's like, I don't know who you are. Why would I support this when you obviously put me as the last thing on your mind? So that approach, how you process and engage Indigenous people, oh, they're looking. They are looking, they are seeing. And if that's the way you're approaching them, I hope they say no. I hope they have the strength to just say no, because that's not the right way to engage people. And to be able to articulate that in a way that that other person could learn is part of what my role is, to be able to tell people, I appreciate that you're intrigued by indigeneity, you want to jump on board, but this is not the way to do it. And how I would recommend you doing it is rethinking your project, come back to me with an actual inclusive partnership where we are making decisions together. And to understand that when we are offering protocol, and we've heard protocol and, you know, that sometimes involves honorarium, and, you know, Chris had mentioned that sometimes accountants don't see that the same way as cultural practitioners. And so it is about having the time to be able to nurture how we will process things like protocol, and to understand that protocol, sometimes when people are describing what is protocol, they give it a very simple meaning, and it's not a simple thing. It is a very deep level, profound aspect of our cultural process. And so when people sometimes call me up and say, we want to engage an elder, how much should I put in my budget? I'm like, it's like asking how long is a rope? It's as long as you need it to be. That protocol that you're offering isn't, somebody may have said, oh, tobacco is a traditional, medicine that we offer often in protocol. Well, you don't just hand over one cigarette and ask someone to cure cancer. You know, that those are not equal. So a way of thinking about protocol is, it might be that that is the only thing I have, is just that one cigarette. It's the last thing I have. And therefore it might mean the entire world, in which case that might be exactly the appropriate thing to give. So protocol is related to how much you want and how much you're willing to give for building relationship, for building a pathway to good work, to good artistic practice and cultural practice. So for example, I mean, not artistically, but when I got married, we had a pipe ceremony with an elder, and we got married both in the traditional way, and then we also got married at the civil way. My mother didn't just offer a pouch of tobacco. She offered, 15 braids of sweetgrass, 15 pouches of tobacco. She offered a wolf hide, a bear hide, food, goods, tools. She had a whole trunk full of things that she was offering to the elder, not a dowry to my to my husband and his family, to the elder because that's how meaningful it was to her. She was praying with everything she had to make sure that that union would be strong and have that reach into the spirit world. So when we're working in this very contemporary world, you know, we want to maybe do a film project or we want to have a conversation like this, we offer that protocol not just as a step to get the work done, but as the most profound step to do the good work in a good way so that our ancestors feel it resonate, that our future descendants will feel that resonate to them as well. So you give as much as you want for that. The other aspect too that I would just ask is that when we're looking to include or to give access to Indigenous people, or if you're non-Indigenous and you're in pursuant of Indigenous knowledge, be aware that some of the things that you're pursuing, Indigenous people haven't had access to it themselves. So for example, language classes, Cree languages or Blackfoot or what have you, when we are in an environment where there are no Indigenous people learning that, be aware and find out if your place is actually taking the place of an Indigenous person trying to rebuild their cultural identity, and be humble and give them that space instead of you. Because there's a way to redress these human rights violations and truth and reconciliation. And in fact, we've mentioned Mr. Barry Belinsky through this, and I'm going to quote him for something that he profoundly told me one time. He said, "We are all in pursuit of truth and reconciliation, but we cannot get to reconciliation without truth first." And we are still absolutely in the truth part. We haven't reached reconciliation. There are many people who were even in doubt that that's even possible, because we're still sharing truth. And so give it that space and time and honor in order for us to get to that good place of reconciliation. So that's my take on those questions. Thank you.
Well, I often think about, you know, the saying goes, put your money where your mouth is. I say, put your time where your mouth is. Your values will show up in how you dedicate your time and energy to something, not what you put your money towards. And so, you know, I appreciated that sentiment in both of your answers. Going back to Sean's question in a very pointed way, if our audience is watching this conversation and hearing about, you know, intercultural and Indigenous involvement in their art practice for the first time and maybe considering it, both of you talked about the need for education. So I'm wondering if you can point to a specific example, resource, something that our audience can go to after this conversation as a next step in their learning journey. And we'll share links to those resources, whatever you share in the chat of this video. So one film, one book, one website, what is one thing that our audience can go as a next step for their own learning? Chris?
Well, at the risk of being like too self-promotional, I do actually think Elder in the Making is not a bad start, and it is available. You can watch it on, I think it's on YouTube right now as well too. It's a good 101 course, and it kind of encapsulates a lot of the learnings that I had. But if we were to go a step behind that, like where did I go for to kind of understand some of the history? Surprisingly, like the 1996 Royal Commission report is worth a good read. Like, I mean, yes, it's like 1,000 pages long, but there are like sections of it that are like, dang, like the education curriculum is right there. They did this like incredible consultation with people all across Canada about like the history and the stories and the terms, like, and it's all written down and it's just gathering dust somewhere on like some shelf, some government shelf. So for those that really want to dig in, there's a lot of wonderful stories in there that are, you can just download it from the web, that a lot of effort was put into writing. I would recommend reading. And sorry, you said a book, a film, and something else?
Just a website, yeah, or something.
Anything else.
Yeah, those two are great examples. Yeah.
Yeah, I think those two do for now. Yeah, and then what Christine said, check out some of the art, the performances, the artworks, things like that. Yeah, wherever you live, look for those artists.
Yeah, absolutely. That's how I answer that question again, is look at the art. And, you know, dreamspeakers.org is our website. And as I mentioned, we are coming up on our 30th anniversary in April, and we are having lots of different films that speak to culture, speak to colonization and decolonization and rights activists and advocates. There's a lot that comes into every single film festival. You can even go to our website and see past film festivals and see some of the past films that we've presented, and you get a sense of, you know, who's who and who's doing what. Here in Edmonton, there's the Dreamspeakers Walk of Honor at Amiskwichiwiskahegan Park on 105th Street and Jasper Avenue. And that is a permanent tribute to Indigenous artistic trailblazers within the film and art industries. And you can get a sense of who are the people who did bust down doors, who did blaze trails for all of us to follow. That's important because, you know, you don't want to think that we invented this. We didn't. There are many people who came before us who fought for our rights to leave the reserve, our rights to re-engage in our cultural practice and our ceremonial practice. And you can take a look at some of those people. There's also just like on our Dreamspeakers YouTube channel, we have some beautiful artistic profiles of different artists working within Alberta, working with some of our partners at Punctuate Theatre. They've got a national Indigenous Writers Network with profiles of each of those writers as well. And then there's also some workshops. And on our workshop, I do have a more thorough, on our YouTube channel, I do have a more thorough presentation on cultural appropriation that I worked on with three other Indigenous artists from different sectors of the industry. And so you can get an even wider perspective on those things. And you can see also, we have some youth films, and it's neat to see how youth are interpreting not only themselves, their identity, but the technologies that they have access to now. And so those are just some of the quick ways. I could recommend books, I could recommend films, but really it's a personal journey. I don't know what is going to spark the curiosity of the different people who might engage in this work, you know, but there's some really good eye-opening work, you know, that any of us can take a look at. And it's really about just beginning. And with any artistic practice, there's a saturation component of the work that we do. So I just encourage that. And I think once you're in it, you'll begin to see the connections and the huge diversity of indigeneity on you know, on the planet. So thank you. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Christine and Chris, for sharing your very generous experiences and knowledge today with us. We're really grateful also to have the support of Canada Council for the Arts and Festival Access AZ to making this CanAsian Arts Network project possible. If you are an Asian Canadian artist looking for more support, visibility, and community connection, we'd love to invite you to join the free network at www.canasianarts.com and follow us on our social media platforms. We hope this online workshop has been very helpful for your artistic journey. And for more in-depth discussion, you can log into the network to access online groups and go to Decolonizing in the Digital Space. See you online, and thank you again so much for our wonderful speakers today.